My name's Elizabeth Buck. I am a fresh market vegetable specialist with Cornell Vegetable Program. That's a Cornell Cooperative Extension Unit. And I'm here talking to you today because even though I'm a fresh market vegetable specialist, what you're seeing on the screen, all those weeds, I'm one of those people that thinks, oh, hey, look at that. Yeah, it's a huge problem, but I get excited. I want to tackle that problem. I'm trained as a weed scientist, did my master's at the University of Guelph in integrated weed management. And I love killing weeds and studying weeds and learning about it. So today, my job is to take you through a very quick introduction for why do we care, and then run through weed ecology, and that will lead us into integrated weed management. This is the first workshop in a whole series, so my job is to lay out the groundwork and get you guys so that you have some familiarity moving to the other workshops. There we go. Okay, so integrated weed management, it consists of four parts, right? I am a weed nerd. I get really excited. So we used to say integrated weed management had three parts, and they even gave us t-shirts, right? So this is the integrated weed management t-shirt. We have the three sectors. Well, now we've updated it, and we say there are four segments to integrated weed management. We have mechanical control, we have biological control, physical control, and chemical control. So this entire workshop is building towards these four controls at the end. So remember them. You'll see these guys again. At this point in time, I want to take a moment and just go over why we care about weed management. So Anna, can you run the first question? Want to know, across this group of about 76 people, what do you spend per acre on weed control? Why do we care? So if you go ahead and take a moment, give you your best ballpark, and I'm asking you just average it across all your crops. The important thing is to remember the labor cost. So if you're hand weeding, what does it cost you to pay those people to weed? Give you maybe another 10 seconds to answer that. Okay, what do we have, Anna?
We're looking, about half of the people who are listening in have weighed in.
Sorry, I'm a little too fast. I'll give you guys a couple more seconds there. Okay, we're gonna cut off there. What do we have?
All right. It looks like 30% are spending more than $500 per acre on weed control.
Okay, wow, this is more than I expected. So we care about weed management because it is one of the biggest costs on the farm in terms of crop protection. So crop protection is going to be, you know, protecting it from pests, diseases, weeds. Sometimes you have to do things like wildlife control. Sometimes there are some other environmental things you need to protect from. Weeds are oftentimes the biggest cost in terms of crop protection. And yet they're the ones that can be the most frustrating. I mean, we can see them. They stay in one place. They don't get up and fly away. They don't blow in on the breeze. They're there. And so let's go through some strategies to try and say, okay, how can we beat that number back? How can we make our weed control more economically and time efficient? So I think, and this is the basic principle behind integrated weed management, that's really moving from this concept of reactive control to proactive management. So proactive management are those weed mitigation practices that are undertaken before weed emergence. So many times when I go out on farm, we're talking about, oh, you have this weed problem, you have that weed problem. It's all reactive. You know, we see the weed, there's an issue. To really succeed in your weed management, you have to move towards proactive. And that's going to include things like a good weed map. So something as simple as just going out in the field a couple times a season and saying, all right, here's my square field. In this corner, I've got this problem. In this section here, I've got this. And up here, well, there's something else going on there. And drawing it out and drawing the boundaries, it takes you a long way. The second step is a correct weed identification, because if you're going to understand the weed biology, you can pick out the strengths and weaknesses to that weed based on its biology. And once you can do that, you can come up with management strategies that will work for that weed. Second part is to understand the environmental influences of that weed. So the one I showed you in the beginning, right? That big field of, that was an onion field full of yellow perennial sow thistle. Perennial sow thistle really needs well-drained soils. That's why we're seeing such a problem in the onion fields, but not in adjacent fields with poorer drainage. So you want to make sure you get the correct weed ID. That'll tell you what the plant needs, what it dislikes, how the environment influences it. And you can, all of these things put together, you can come up with a proactive management strategy, okay? So with that, I want to get into some weed biology and really go through a couple pieces related to the identification of the weeds. So at this point in time, I'm going to say, what's my second question? I have a series of questions for you guys. We'll hold off on the next question. So, biology. First question to ask yourself, do I have a broadleaf plant or do I have a grass plant? So a broadleaf plant, they're the ones that come up and they have two cotyledons. Think of a bean or a peanut, right? When you're eating that peanut, it splits in half. Those are the two cotyledons. Every single broadleaf has two cotyledons to it. As a whole, that family, they're easily severed, that they're easily cut off right here when they're young. So the top of the plant is green. These are the two cotyledons here. This area is called the hypocotyl, and here you have the roots. When a broadleaf is young, if you cut this, it will die, it won't come back, okay? There's lots of herbicides that work on broadleafs. They have a ton of crop relatives. And what I was talking about, easily severed right there. And they most often have tap roots. The rooting structure is going to come into play once you start trying to remove these things. Do they have a deep tap root, or do they have more of a fibrous root system that's going to go out? So broadleafs. We're going to contrast this with grasses. So there are true grasses and there are some grass-like plants. So grass-like plants include things like garlic. It's not a grass, but it's more grass than it is broadleaf. Grasses have veins in their leaves that all run in the same direction. So do alliums. So that's going to be things like garlic and wild chives, okay? Corn, that's a grass. And sedges. Sedges are not a grass, but they still have that parallel veination. So that's one thing to look at. Do I have a grass? Do I have parallel veins? Does it look kind of like grass leaves? The important thing there is that grasses often have those fibrous root systems that go out and form a mat. Think of like a chunk of sod, right? You can peel that back because of those fibrous roots. They often have their growing point at or in the ground. This is how you're able to mow your lawn and it grows back, is that that growing point is down way low where it can't be eaten by herbivores. They tend to root at the nodes. So let's go over what a node is. You see where this leaf comes together? Where a leaf meets a stem, that's called a node, okay? And so some plants have the ability to grow roots there if that node touches the ground. The other thing about grasses and nodes is they all have collars at their nodes, okay? So the collar has two parts. It's where the leaf blade sticks out, meets the stem, and looking at the collar is where you're going to do your grass ID. Downside to grasses is that we have fewer herbicide groups that work effectively on them. So this is why you need to know, do I have a grass or do I have a broadleaf? Second thing you want to know is, what's my life cycle strategy of this plant? So an annual is a plant that's going to be 1 year. You know, I'm going from seed in the beginning of the year and seed at the end of the year. I got to make a quick life and get in, get out, get done, make seeds. I'm going to be dead come winter. So annuals, they're very quick to become established in a field. They're all quite vulnerable when they're young, and they really put an emphasis on seed production. We have two types of annuals. We have winter annuals and spring-summer annuals. So spring and summer annuals are those that are going to germinate in the spring and summer. Our winter annuals are the ones that germinate in the fall, go dormant through the winter, or just sit under the snow, and by the time spring rolls around, as soon as that snow's out, they're there, little tiny rosette stages, and they just bolt and take off. So they're getting a jump start on the season because they actually began in the fall. Okay, so we have fall and or winter annuals, and then we have spring or summer annuals. Okay. So how do they propagate? How do they multiply? Annuals are all about seeds, and they want to distribute those seeds because they know they're not going to be around next year. You'll notice I have anthropomorphize the weeds. It helps me think about them, okay? So they know they're going to die. They're going to make seeds. And how are they going to get those seeds places? They're going to distribute seeds by shattering their seed heads and letting that seed fall on the ground. We call that seed rain. Some of the seeds fly. Everyone's familiar with the dandelions, those flying seeds. And then animals and man. A lot of seeds will very happily go through the gut tract of an animal. That's one of the way that raspberries get spread throughout woods, right? Birds eat the raspberries, seed goes through the bird, and then the seed's deposited by the bird elsewhere, complete with a little fertilizer package. Same thing happens with cows, sheep, horses. Man, we tend to move seeds around on equipment, in our boots. And then you've got certain kinds of seed that are just unpleasant, like burr seeds. Those will stick to you and move with you in animals. Some of the other ways that plants, annual plants, will propagate themselves, they can take cuttings. So something like purslane is going to root along cut stems. Grabweed and chickweed do that too by putting those extra roots down at the nodes. If something were to come along and hack part of the plant off, then the rest of it can continue to survive. Biennials are plants that take 2 years from seed to seed. This is different than a winter annual. A winter annual really isn't going through a full calendar year. A biennial wants to spend the first part of the year, or the first year, as a small rosette, and the second year it's going to bolt. If anyone's familiar with the yellow flowered, oversized dill looking plant that grows along a lot of the highway edges, that's a plant called wild parsnip. So the first year it spends its life as a little tiny rosette, and the second year it bolts up and flowers. So that's a biennial life cycle. To manage that one, you're going to manage it more like a perennial in one regard, because you gotta get that overwintering thing dead. And then you're also going to manage it like an annual because it still wants to produce a lot of seed. Finally, we have perennials, and perennials live a very long time. They all have overwintering structures because they need to make it through the winter. They have to put their energy somewhere so that way they can pop back out, right? What this means is that when they pop out in the spring, you can almost always identify an overwintering perennial because they come up and they're hefty. Those guys got some energy. They're not some little tiny weak seedling. They're vigorous. They have large emerging shoots. They can grow quickly, and they're very competitive. They're going to propagate in multiple ways. They're going to rely on propagation of cut stems or cut root pieces. They're going to produce seeds. They're going to produce nutlets and bulbs, and you name it, you have a perennial that's going to try it because they're there for the long haul, and they're going to diversify their reproduction strategies. One of the ones that's most troublesome when we talk about weeds are rhizomes. So this photo here is a picture of a rhizome. And a rhizome looks like an underground root, right? This skinny little piece coming off, that's the root. The rest of it's a rhizome. And what makes it a rhizome are all of these little buds sticking out. And when I say buds, these are shoots. They're gonna grow shoots up and grow leaves. So this here is actually an underground stem. When we have weeds that have rhizomes, they're called rhizomatous weeds. We can trace this underground stems coming off of a mother plant. So here's a mother plant. Here's one rhizome here. Here's another rhizome. There's a rhizome. And so as those rhizomes grow out, they throw shoots up and they get more and more in plants. What happens is all these plants on the top feed the energy back down the bottom, grow longer rhizomes. So thistles, sow thistles, Canada thistle, nut sedge. This is a rhizome that ends in a little tiny nutlet, bindweed or annual morning glories, and certain types of cresses. Those are all rhizomatous weeds. They're all perennials. So again, the perennials, they need to survive the winter, so they have to put something somewhere. What are plants making? They're making carbohydrate, sugar, starch, sugar, alcohol, whatever it is. They're making carbohydrate, right? In the spring, this is the root reserves of a perennial plant. In the spring, it's really high because they haven't used it yet. As they start growing, they're feeding off that bottom feeding off the storage organ to put the shoots out fast. About the time they flower, they switch over from using the energy from below ground to mostly using the energy that they're producing above ground. And they want to use that energy to make flowers, set seeds. Once they get the seeds off and their flowers are done, they're going to take the energy that they're making from the leaves and start replenishing the underground storage organs. And it frosts and they slowly deplete it down for the winter. So this is going to be really important in how we manage a perennial, is understanding that I have a perennial and I need to kill what's below ground, because until you kill what's below ground, you're not going to get rid of a perennial weed problem. So a little bit more, then I'm going to stop and ask you a question, okay? So we need to know a broadleaf or annual. We need to know the life cycle strategy of the plant. We need to know, is this a cool season weed or a warm season weed? Cool season weeds, they're easy. They germinate when it's cool out. That's going to be early spring or in the fall. You often get two generations in a calendar year. So you get the generation that's germinating in the spring. You don't get any in the fall or in the summer. And then we get a second generation germinating in the fall. Sometimes they'll germinate in the fall and complete their life cycle. Sometimes they'll germinate in the fall over winter and complete their life cycle in the spring. Really common types are chickweed. What you're seeing in the photo is chickweed infestation in a early greens planting. You can hardly see the lettuce here. This was a complete loss. So chickweeds, a lot of the mustard type species, bluegrass, some of the mints, dead nettle, and horseweed. So horseweed is a type of aster. Warm season weeds, on the other hand, they're going to germinate in the warm season. These are often our most notorious and nasty and vigorous weeds in an agricultural setting, because we're also growing warm season crops, right? So these are going to be things that come up later in the season, often starting in May. Their main emergence window is going to be somewhere between like May and mid-July. Pretty much every time you get more rain, you'll get another flush of weeds. This includes grasses, so things like foxtails and crabgrasses and barnyard grass, broadleaf weeds like nightshades, pigweeds, lamb quarters, gallon soga. It's horrible weed on a vegetable farm, purslane, and velvet leaf. And then there's finally other factors. So this is the last piece to know about your weeds. This is why you need the right weed ID, so you can identify all of these pieces. Weeds are often really, they're meant to colonize areas first. So because they evolved to colonize disturbed areas, they're better at tolerating less than ideal conditions. Sometimes you'll find that weeds can tolerate really sandy or really clay soils that your crops might struggle more in. Because the crops are struggling more, the weeds get an advantage. They can take different drainage conditions. Some can take compaction, prostrate knotweed and purslane. They do very well in compacted soils. They can take varying light conditions and even wind patterns. So wind patterns come about because if you have a weed that blows with seed, dandelions, you're going to start with the dandelions in one patch, they're going to move downwind. So this is going to end my section on weed biology and why it's important. I highly, highly recommend this book. This is Weeds of the Northeast. This is the book that almost all the extension agents carry around in the car. So if you're like, hey, I have a weed problem, we have that in our car. We don't really know it off the top of our head. We look it up in this. Fantastic book for weed ID, very easy to use, goes through, shows you lots of photos, boldface fonts the characteristics to look for, has pictures to teach you what those characteristics look like, comparison charts. That's your weed ID book. All right, and with that, gonna pause. Do we have any questions, Anna?
I have a couple people with their hands up. Do you want me to launch your question about weed ID?
Yeah, why don't you launch the weed ID question, and I'll answer maybe one question while you guys look at that?
Sure. Bruce Howden, I'm unmuting you if you would like to speak. I think you maybe hit your raise hand button. Still haven't gotten the hang of this. Oh, there we go. Bruce, go ahead.
I had trouble. I don't have the screen where she's showing the weeds. I have the screen where she is.
Okay. Now, when you're looking at your view options, like if you hover over view options, there's a little drop down menu that says hide video panel. You may be able to monkey around with that.
All right. And for those of you who haven't used Zoom before, it takes a little getting used to. If you go to the top of your screen, you should get the view options. You also have the chat box. In the chat box, you can send messages to the entire group, or you can send them right to Anna. And if you have problems with any audio or visual things, just shoot a chat right to Anna, and she'll be able to answer that while we're moving on. All right, how confident do you guys feel regarding Weed ID? Let's see what your answers are.
Looks like some confident people.
Yeah, I like this. Good. Okay, so you feel like you can ID it. Next time you ID it, think through these factors about its biology and life cycle strategies, okay? What's your next question, Anna?
Gary Seidner, you had your hand up.
You hear me?
Yes.
I can just barely hear you.
Yeah, I didn't have my hand up.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so we'll move on.
And LaCroix? Well, we'll see. It doesn't look like there's a lot of questions. Maybe Scott Lewins, did you want to weigh in on something? I can unmute you.
Hi, Anna and Elizabeth. Thank you. The original question about amount of money spent on weeding, it really just depends a huge amount on whether or not you're organic or conventional, doesn't it?
No. Not actually. So organic farms tend to have more weed problems, but you have to balance out the labor that you're putting in versus the cost of the herbicides. For example, those onions that are grown in the muck, the very first photo I showed you before the slide started, those guys are all conventional and they're using probably four different herbicides across the season, and they're still spending an average of $200 to $250 an acre hand weeding because it's the crop that they're growing, okay? So it all comes down to really your management of your weeds on the whole. So I've seen some organic farms where they have very low weed pressure. I've seen some conventional farms where it's horrendous weed pressure. So I think that's more of a farm by farm or crop by crop thing. All right, with that, I'm gonna make a suggestion moving forward. Questions, why don't we pop them all into chat box, and then Anna can go through and say like, oh, a lot of people are wondering about this. We'll condense that down a little bit, okay? So if you have a question, put it in the chat box, send it off, and we're gonna keep on rolling, all right?
Sounds good.
Here we go. So, weed seed bank management. I love this photo. Reason being that this is a milkweed, right? Friendly for our butterflies, not so great in fields that you want to harvest for forage. But this is seed shatter. This is about to be seed rain. And not only do a couple of them fall to the ground, but these are really set up to fly. You just see each and every single one, get an idea of just how many seeds are in this thing. So, weed seed bank management. What is a seed bank? Every single plant is going to produce thousands of seeds. I'll go through some examples in a moment or two. And not all the seeds germinate in the first year. It's not a good reproduction strategy to put all your eggs in one basket, right? So your seeds, if you're a plant, you want your seeds to germinate over a length of time. And that means that seeds can remain viable for many years. We use the analogy to a bank, right? You're going to deposit a little bit of each paycheck. You're not going to spend all that paycheck, if you can help it, in the next month or so. You want to carry some of that over. This is exactly what the weeds want to do. So what we get is a seed bank in every field, and we feel very lucky. Yay, a weed seed bank to deal with. Lucky us. These are examples of some weeds and their seeds, okay? The first photo, this is a common lamb's quarters, and it might look like these are chunky seeds, but if you look close, these are actually the flowers You see a little anthers there? This is the flower, so it's not yet to seed stage. It's important to be able to tell how mature the seeds are on your plant, because a key part to managing the weed seed bank is preventing seeds from going in. So if you can't tell what stage your seed development's at, you're gonna struggle to keep the seeds out. So this is an example of one in flower. The next one is a foxtail. And you can see there are a couple with dried up anthers. Most of the seeds are green. This is a stage where the seeds are not yet mature. And on the far side, we have a Venice mallow, or a 4 o'clock. And this is fully mature seed in one cluster. Okay, so there's this mature seed pod. The seeds are shattering. This is a seed pod that is almost mature, so it's not opened up yet, but the seeds are probably already mature and capable of germinating. And in the background, we have one that's not mature. So this is a point that plants that have long flowering windows will have seeds set over a long period of time. Any weed that's in the mustard family is going to be really notorious for this, okay? They have continual flowering and continual seed set. Buckwheat is a crop that does the same thing. So talk about this weed seed bank. When we talk about in terms of longevity, these are some very common weed species. We're talking the number of years it takes to get a single batch of seed reduced down 50% in viability. So 50% of them won't germinate, or 99% of them won't germinate. Look at this. I mean, common lamb's quarters. We're talking 78 years until 99% of them won't germinate. Just that's like 3 or 4 generations of researchers that kept this single trial going. Being like, when will they stop? They finally stopped. And that's one of the cases that it seems extreme, right? That's why we look more at the 50% years to reduction. 50% of your weeds is still too many, so it's good to know how long does it take. I use tables like this to prioritize which weed species in this field am I really going to go out there and get all of the escapes, the ones that I can't control and get big. Which ones do I have to prioritize getting rid of before they make seed? So if I'm in a field, I have some shepherd's purse, I have some yellow foxtails, I have some giant foxtails, and I have common lamb's quarters, I would use a table like this to say, well, after a year, 50% of my giant foxtail seeds aren't going to germinate, and I'll have pretty much all of them no longer viable in 5 years. I'm not going to prioritize those, but every single lamb's quarters I see, I got to go out there and get that thing out. Okay, so this is an example of some lifespans. But how many do they make? Let's get this little box out of the way. So you'll see down here, hopefully you can see right here. See this biology of Canadian weeds? This is a series of science articles. And what they go through is they go and they compile all the research done on certain weed species and they put it into one paper. So if you want to know anything there is to know about common ragweed, biology of Canadian weeds is your resource to go to. That's going to tell you all about the ecology and give you some IPM strategies for that plant. This is where I pulled that information from. So this tells you average production ranges for the number of seeds produced on each of these types of plants. Point out pigweeds, 5,000 to 30,000 for our common pigweeds. If you have something like a Palmer amaranth or a water hemp, the really nasty kinds, those regularly are over 100,000 seeds per plant. Your lamb's quarters, they average 72,000 weeds per plant. Highly plastic means that they'll mature seed in the beginning of July, they'll mature seed in October. This is why, combined with the longevity of seed, we really don't want to let those go to seed. Velvet leaf, they produce a lot fewer seeds, but they have a 50-year viability window. That's another high priority. Quackgrass is a perennial. Remember how I said perennials pick multiple strategies? It's not going to rely so much on seed production. It's relying more on its rhizomes and getting its rhizomes chopped up to spread seeds. So by knowing what your seed production potential is, knowing what your longevity window is, and when the seed matures, that's what you're going to put together to come up with management plans for the seed bank. Any questions in the chat box, Anna?
No, I think that everybody's just taking it all in right now.
Okay. So Your characteristics of the seeds are going to impact your management. Small seeds, those are things like pigweed, lamb's quarters, chickweed, most of your annual species, they produce a lot of seed, and each individual seed is small. Those are going to germinate from the top quarter to half inch of soil. Very few of the small seeds will germinate at all below an inch of soil. What that means is below an inch of soil, they're not going to try to germinate. Okay, that's very different than trying and failing. So if you're the top quarter and you try to germinate from the top quarter inch, you're probably going to make it. If you're down around 1 inch and you get the germination cues to germinate, you may make it. You may not have enough energy to make it up into the light and you may die. That's called a fatal germination. If you're below 1 inch in your small seed, you never get the right germination cues to germinate. And so those small seeds are relying on the ratio of red light to far red light. And about 1 inch is where that ratio changes in the soil. So that's how they get that germination cue of, I'm too deep, I'm not going to try, or I'm in the top inch, I'm going to go for it. Large seeds, they germinate from much deeper. This is an example of a large seed weed. This is a common cocoburr. This is the cotyledon. See how the cotyledon looks different than leaves? It doesn't have a lot of veins in it. Huge cotyledon means huge seed. This guy will germinate from very deep in the soil, and very deep for a seed is about 2 inches, maybe 3 inches, okay? And that's got lots of energy to make it up, so they're gonna germinate from deeper. If your seeds have a hard seed coat, they're going to promote longevity. So lamb's quarters, hard seed coat. Velvet leaf, very hard seed coat. They're gonna be longer living seeds. And dormancy, so seeds have two types of dormancy. They have innate dormancy, where the seed is like not ready yet, not gonna germinate. And then they have external dormancy, where they're waiting on an environmental condition. A really common one that keeps weeds from germinating is water. They need water to soak it in to germinate, right? But if you have a hard seeded seed coat, you need to break that hard seed coat up. And so they may need to go through a winter first to damage that seed coat so they can take in the water. So these are the characteristics of seeds that are going to impact your management. How? Well, I'll get to how. First, when your seeds come up, you guys have probably noticed they don't come up consistently. They tend to come up in flushes. And this is an example of a weed flush. All of these weeds here are less than 2 leaves old, okay? Except that guy, he's got 3 leaves. So here we have, this is a foxtail grass. This is a barnyard grass. All these little ones here are crabgrasses. And all these little red guys, those are all purslanes. This is a weed flush. You got one pigweed there. A weed flush, okay? So when we're working with our seed bank, this is how we're expecting our germination to come up. This comes with certain temperatures being reached. More often we see it rains. 3-4 days later, we get a flush like this. Or we disturb the soil, we get a flush like this. So we can use this natural tendency of the weed seeds to germinate in groups to make withdrawals from our seed bank. So the best way to make a withdrawal is to do a stale seedbed technique. This is where we force a germination flush, then we kill the flush, rinse and repeat. So in this case, this would work because the flushes come up, you know, the ground was worked up, all the seeds were in the top inch, they got rain, they germinated, and now I would come through and I would cultivate them out, and that would disturb the soil just a little bit, and I'd let it sit, and another flush would come up with the next drain, and then I would go through and destroy those. So that strategy when you're doing a stale seed bed comes down to being able to work the ground a little bit early so you can make that bed for your plants. So you're gonna plow, you wait a little bit, then you fit the ground, you wait a little bit. That's when you run like a blind harrow or something through really shallow before you plant, and then you come back and you cultivate. This works really well for your late planted crops. If you want to do this technique on an early planted crop, you can actually start the year before, make your beds up the year before. The trick here is that wait period. So if you're blessed with the weather to do it, this is something where you can plow, give it a week. Okay, you were looking for about a week between each of these events, and oftentimes a little bit of rain will help. There are some growers who are really serious about their stale seed bedding. And if they've worked the ground and they're waiting for a second flush of weeds to come up so they can kill those, and they don't get rain, they'll actually put on a quarter inch of water to force those weeds up so they can eliminate them. And every time you work the ground, you just want to work that top inch, okay? Inch, no deeper than 2 inches, because that's where the weeds are that you want to make germinate. If you work deeper than that, you're going to be pulling up weeds from deeper, and you're going to not be making the withdrawal where your crop is going to go. On the flip side, we have seed rain, and this is a foxtail, a yellow foxtail. These are the seeds on the ground. And if you look closely, the seeds don't all look the same, right? So this is an intact seed. These are intact seeds, but that one and this one and these, they look a little hollow. That one there, hollow. What happened was, this is a fairly large seeded weed, and something came along and ate these seeds. So when we have our weed known, like we know this is a yellow foxtail, we know that's going to produce around 3,000 seeds per plant. We know it's going to have 3 years to 50% reduction, 5 years to 99% reduction. That was all on the slides I showed you guys before, right? We can come and say, all right, what's our best way to deal with the seed that falls? This is a species, being large seeded, that tends to be eaten by little beetles and other things running around the fields. So with a large seeded weed, we can leave that on the soil surface. These weeds will be, weed seeds will be damaged by frost. They'll be eaten. Some of them will just rot and decay. Whereas if we were to take this and till it in, then we'd be promoting these seeds to live longer. So your strategy, if you have a bad field of, say, velvet leaf and it's got large seeds, you want to leave those seeds on the soil surface going into winter. If you have a lot of small weeds, you're going to deal with that differently. Okay. The other thing with seed rain, what's the best way to prevent seed rain, guys? Not allow seed production, right? So don't let them go to seed. Just yank them out, cut the tops off, whatever you have to do. Just know that if you're going to cut the tops off and they've already flowered and started setting seed, if the seed is immature, a ton of weeds, and every time they do these studies, they identify more and more species that can mature seed off of a cut plant. So if the seed is immature, you cut it, the seed can continue maturing as that cut top dries down. So if you're going to go with the cut mature seed or immature seed off, make sure you do it at flowering, not after flower. You'll have much more success. So I'm going to pause here. I have a couple more poll questions for you. Can we run through those, Anna?
Sure. All right, I'm going to launch this poll, but I do have a question.
Okay, what question came up in the chat box?
Yes, the question is about bracken fern. First of all, what is bracken fern? That's my side of the question. And this grower is interested in the best way to manage bracken fern in blueberry.
In blueberry? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm not real familiar with bracken fern, but almost all ferns need a pretty good water source because that's the way they reproduce. They have a stage that is really dependent on moisture. So we tend to see them in areas with poor drainage. This is a weed where managing your environmental conditions might be more effective than managing the plant itself. So if you're in a blueberry patch, and blueberries are another one, they're a very tolerant plant, they like low pH soils. Their natural environment closely matches the natural environment of ferns. So we get a lot of crossover there. My suggestion would be to look into the biology of the bracken fern, and I'd be willing to bet there's probably a water component related to that. You may also be able to address it by changing pH. Those are broad strokes. All right.
Would you have similar answer to hay fern eradication? Is that a similar situation?
Never heard of hay fern. But ferns in general, they all pretty much, I should say, many ferns are going to rely on the same things: a bit of shade, lower pH soils, neutral to lower pH soils, and usually moisture isn't lacking. How's our poll looking? What do you guys have for answers?
All right, let's see. A lot of hand weeding, but it looks like there's a little bit of everything.
Mm-hmm. Physical barriers, I imagine there's a lot of that with, okay, good. So this matches what I see on farms. It's, no one is using just one strategy. Most folks are using 3 to 5 strategies on a regular basis. Good. And yes, I do not know of any vegetable farms that don't do hand weeding. All right, so we're gonna close this poll. Can you ask the next poll? We have another poll question and right, yeah, I sent 3 poll questions for during the talk. And I'll take another chat question while you guys are answering that.
All right, how about this? When you are creating a brand new veggie field that is currently a diversity of weeds and grasses, what's the best strategy to begin minimizing weeds? Would you suggest your stale seed bed?
I think it depends on what kind of weeds are in the field. So I would have a different set of recommendations for a pasture versus noxious weeds versus just run the mill. I've been fallow for a couple of years.
So get that weed ID book out and figure it out before.
Right. And I like that question. I'm going to cut off at that question because you're perfect segue into our next section of the talk. All right. What's our answers here? Pretty good. All right. I'm liking it. So I'm going to run through how we take this ecology and management stuff and start turning it into some useful strategies. Okay. Ready? I'm going to readjust this so that way hopefully you guys don't lose as much of the slides. And here we go. So it's all about proactive management, right? We want weed mitigation practices that we take before weed emergence. We're never going to get away from reactive management strategies, but it's those reactive management strategies that get us behind, get us caught in binds, right? Oh, the weeds came up, I lost control of them. Now it's taking forever to pick because I have to go through the weeds, or my equipment doesn't move through as well, or hey, my workers hate the fact that they're in a field of thistles, or my favorite, so often I see much more severe disease problems because weeds are choking up a field, messing up the airflow, and they're messing up the airflow, so then humidity sticks on the leaves, we get more disease problems, or they're stressing the plants out because they're taking the water and the nutrients. So we want to get away from that. We want to be proactive. You've seen this slide before. We're going to move right on. I found this. It came out of a vegetable area. I was on my way back to the office, end up behind this thing. My question is this a weed prevention tool? So that's a mower. That is a big mower. They were going out and mowing their fields. They lost control of the field and they decided that they're going to go mow the weeds off instead. They were walking away from it. Is that a weed prevention tactic? Another case, you know, you're done with a field and you're going to go mow it off, mow the crop, mow the weeds. I say no. This is a 3.5 foot tall lamb's quarters next to a pigweed, next to some grasses there, and I don't know what else. All of these things were probably bouncing along, dropping seeds in the field as they went. This is not weed prevention. That's an introduction source. So your equipment is a notoriously common weed introduction source. Not only are they bouncing off the back, but up inside there. Remember how I said weed seeds will mature off a plant once they're cut? They use that drying plant tissue to suck out what they need and finish up. I bet you anything, on the inside of this, we've got tons of weed seeds up in that mower because it probably isn't cleaned out ever. I would say if you do a lot of mowing like that and you know you go through a field with big seeds, just take it back home, park in a driveway, pressure wash up underneath there, okay? So equipment is a common source. Combines are horrendously bad. One of the reasons we have so much spread of really difficult multiple herbicide resistant weeds is because they're moving around in combines from one corn and grain production region to the next. Other sources of introduction, animals, be wild animals or domestic ones on your farm. Most of the seeds pass through their guts. Compost, seed contamination in your crop lots, mulch contamination if you're using hay or straw in the fields, make sure it's clean. You don't want the crappy hay that the dairy farmer has left over from last year because it's probably crappy hay left over from last year because it's full of weed seeds and other junk. And then field edges. A lot of stuff will come in from the edges of fields where it's not such a priority to manage it. So first thing, think about your introduction sources, try to reduce them. primary tillage is an awesome weed management technique. I already talked about if you have large seed weeds, you're going to handle them different than if you have small seed weeds. Perennials in our primary tillage, that's a little bit of a different story. So when you're using your primary tillage, just stop for a second, put a lens towards weed management with it. If you have small seeds, plow them under deep. If you normally put things down to 6 inches, set the discs to 8 inches or 9 inches. After a really bad year, you just lost control. You have ragweeds and lambscores and pigweeds everywhere. Tons of seed rain. Put them down there. Put them down 2 to 3 inches deep than you normally plow. And then you have to work it more shallowly the next few years. You have to work it at the 5 or 6 inches instead. Let them down there. Let them die. Large seeds, keep them near the surface with your primary tillage. When you have perennials, they're going to want to propagate with their underground portions. So those rhizomes, every time you cut those, you're making more. So if you have perennials, you want to catch them when they're still patchy in little areas of the field. You want to work around those sections and work those sections less. So many times I've seen where a perennial weed, like quackgrass, will get caught in tillage equipment, and you go out in the field and it's there in strips. And I can ask, like, hey, which way do you work your field? And usually guess right based on the pattern of the perennial weeds in the field. If they have rhizomes, they're dragging with the tillage equipment. You can expose and chop things with thick tap roots late in the fall. Those are things that you want to go after with a disc. You want to chop them up as fine as you can. If you have fields with rhizomes, again, discs, perennial weed fields are tough. What happens every time you cut it, you make a propagule. You're going to make another plantlet, but you decrease the amount of energy that plantlet has to draw from. So if you have 20 plants with roots this size versus 10 plants with roots this size, the 10 plants with roots this size each are going to have more energy and be more of a problem than the 20 plants with lower roots this size, because they're going to be smaller. You're going to have more opportunity to kill them. So if you have a perennial weed problem that's no longer in a patch, and you go in and you go after it with primary tillage, you have got to come back and get it again and again and again. It's going to look worse before it gets better, but you will make it better. You just got to keep hitting it. Fitting cultivation, already went over stale seed bedding, already went over promoting seed germination. Those are our annual tactics for the perennials. I just talked through this, right? If you have a perennial patch, you're going to have to allow some regrowth. We're aiming at like 3 inches, 2 to 5 inches. And then you go in there, work it up again, work it up, work it up. Okay, prevention, this is mechanical disruption. So not all forms of mechanical disruption are created equal. We have three ways that they kill. You can either cut them, you can bury them, or you can uproot your weeds. Your selection of your cultivation equipment has to match your weed's weakness. If you're trying to bury a grass, they're growing points below ground. You're not gonna be successful. If you're trying to cut off a grass, the growing point's not successful, or below ground, you're not successful. Grasses you need to uproot. If you're trying to cut a purslane or something else that roots at the nodes or grows new roots really easily, cutting it off or uprooting it, I would probably go for uprooting it and making sure I have a lot of action on my mechanical to shake off that soil. Okay, so lots of different types. You could have an entire talk on mechanical cultivations. Just gonna point this out. These are silicone finger weeders to work the edge of bed. They do a nice job. Competition, this is all about who's going to win, right? We have our weeds that are competitive. Some are just competitive species like crabgrass, more aggressive than annual bluegrass. This competition is not just simply a matter of species. It comes down to the size. The relative time of emergence is huge. If your corn gets ahead of your weeds, the corn will win. If your weeds get out ahead of your corn, even the corn's this massive plant, the weeds will win, right? And it comes down to selecting the right crop versus weed combination, or cover crop versus weed combination. And that's all about mismatching or avoidance, okay? So many of our crops in vegetable land have weedy relatives. We gotta avoid putting the families together. So some examples, we got lettuce and dandelions, both asters, cabbage, kale, kohlrabi, Brussels sprouts, they're mustards, right? So then we're gonna deal with our shepherd's purse, our mustard weeds, it's gonna be a nightmare. Tomatoes and peppers versus nightshades. Horrible, horrible combination. And then small grains and grasses. We mismatch because we want to get differing environmental needs, differing life cycle times, and we gain the advantage. If we have a mismatch between crop and weeds, we can use so many more herbicides. Because if the herbicide kills the weed, it's probably going to kill a related crop. That's why we get more options. So mismatching isn't only with families. It's putting a warm season vegetable in a field with cool season weeds, or cool season vegetable in a field with warm season weeds. That's huge. You can make so much progress by offsetting your weed and crop seasons. If you have a bad summer weed problem, stale seed bed it, or go in with early corn or transplant aggressive vine crops. Things are super competitive. Tighten up your spacing. So maybe you leave a little bit more in-row space and tighten up the between-row space, or alternatively, a little more space between row. This is more popular. More space between row where you can cultivate more easily. Tighten up the in-row spacing, okay? Because the plants, they have like a square meter, your square feet that they want. You can change the dimensions. And then cultivate to cool the kill the cool season weeds. One thing I love is a smothering summer cover crop. So if you put, I have a field full of warm season weeds like lamb's quarters and pigweeds. You plant that early to peas. Smother cover it with buckwheat in the winter. You're going to get like three disruption cycles from tillage, and then you're going to come back in the fall with a fall crop of greens. Awesome solution. Some more on mismatching. Sod's favorite perennials. You got to mow them or graze them. If you're rotating with a dairy operation, you put in alfalfa. Remember, that's good. Favorite perennials in some grasses. Anytime you can get disruption, stale seed bed, clean fallow, smothering summer cover. Fantastic. General rules, this is more or less what I said, just I want in there a second time to emphasize it. Corn and herbicides, if you have a really nasty problem, corn and herbicides are a great way to cover that and get it done. Always working to manage the seed bank, preventing seed rain. Okay. When you're cover cropping for weeds, they have a general cover cropping recommended rate. You have to ask your seed dealer, is this like a, you know, what is the purpose of this cover crop? Is this a rate to use for weeds? Because oftentimes if you're trying to smother weeds with your cover crop, you got to bump up that sowing rate. You have broadleaf covers for grassy weeds, grain or rapidly closing summer covers for broadleaf weeds. So buckwheat is awesome. Sorghum Sudan is awesome. In the winter, small grains work because that's a cash crop you're going into. You can use mustards. This is a field of tillage radishes. They're doing a fantastic job smothering those late germinating summer crops. But over here in the corner, we've got a bunch of winter annuals germinating, and they were all throughout the field. They weren't doing a good job because they have a similar life cycle, right? So it's knowing what you have in your field, what you're targeting. Various cultural practices. We got mulching, all sorts of mulching. That's plastic mulch, living dead mulch, tarping, this type of physical barrier. Managing your fringe habitat is big. I already talked about exclusion. Don't let new things in. If you've got a quack grass patch in your drive row, deal with it there. Keep them in the ditch banks. Awful, awful thing when the town comes through, cleans out the ditch, dumps in your field. Not polite, but that's where problems can come from. This is a failure. They did a great job preventing in the row. Awesome weed control. They used the plastic mulch very successfully to prevent the crabgrass coming up in their pepper crop, but they never managed it between the row, so they never got ahead. They reactively managed for year, current year. They did not proactively manage for this year. So don't be this person. You guys are going to be able to do so much better. Last thing to think about, no free lunches. Our weeds are greedy. They like to take more nutrients than they need. Primary example, red root pigweed. That thing will hoard nitrogen, it hoards phosphorus. So any extra luxurious fertilizer you're putting out, they're going to take up. This is the fertilizer uptake, stylized because it is. You have this lag phase, okay? Everything has a lag phase. They have the uptake phase and then the phase where it's too much. Excess fertility, okay? If you're putting all of your fertilizer for your crop out early, the weeds are just going to take it and run with it. You gave them a free lunch, they're going to get the jump on your crop. They're just evolutionarily designed for it. And with the perennials, we have the low stage where their root reserves are down. We want to till, hit them every time the root reserves are down, get that out of the ground. I think managing perennials, this is the case for fall herbicides. This is my strongest case for ever using herbicides. If you have a bad perennial weed problem, a fall herbicide that translocates, something like Roundup or 2,4-D or dicamba, those are going to get down. That's going to be your fastest way to get rid of fall perennials. And with that, I just have recap of the IPM strategies. Here are physical weed management strategies, including thermal and electric. Okay, you can steam your weeds, you can electrocute them. Those are becoming popular. Biological control, the question's there because there are always more methods being developed. Chemical weed management. And cultivation, the questions on cultivation are because that's an entirely different workshop. That's all I got. Thank you guys. There are a couple post questions because I like to ask pre-questions, post questions, see if I did my job because I like the feedback. Anna can throw those up and I'm happy to stay online, take any questions. Thank you everyone for checking the series out. I hope you come back for another workshop.
Awesome. And just to remind you guys that a lot of the techniques that Elizabeth mentioned, we will be covering in the weeks to follow. So there'll be another session like this for the next 4 weeks at noon on Friday. Next week will be on herbicides. The following week will be on mechanical weed control. And after that will be some of these newer techniques, solarization. There was a question about solarization in carrots. Hopefully you'll be able to tune in for more details on that. One more time, the name of the book, the Weed ID book that you suggested? Weeds of the Northeast, and who is that written by?
These guys.
Well, I will send out the details of that book along with a follow-up email for all of you all. If you have any more questions, please let us know and we'll do our best to follow up with anything particular. So I'm going to end that poll just to get a result.
Yep. Oh, seed bank control. Guys, this warms my heart. I did my job. All right, can we throw up the last question?
And which one was that?
How they feel making management plans now. Or do you feel better prepared?
Yeah, how confident do you feel about developing weed management plans?
Mm-hmm.
Half of our respondents said they felt pretty confident.
Okay, so I'm going to assume that didn't change much. You guys still feel confident. That's great. Again, I'm happy to hang on the line. If you have any burning questions, I'll do my best to answer them. Thank you, everyone.
Great. Have a nice rest of your day. All right, I'm going to log off.
All right, so, all right, good. I guess we don't have any questions hanging on then. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I'll have a debrief with you later.
Sounds good.